Well, good morning. Welcome to Sykes and First. Won't you stand with us this morning? Let's open with a song of praise. I hope that you came to worship the Lord this morning. Amen.
Come on into the house of worship. Come on into the place of praise. Come on into the holy refuge. You'll find Jesus, your heart in your bed. If you feel that you have a problem, and your time is closing in, if you ever need a friend, just come on in. Come on into a house of worship. Come on into the place of praise. Come on into the holy refuge. You'll find Jesus, your heaven to bear. Just come on in. This is here's a place where you find refuge. This is a place where you find peace. This is a place where you find healing. This is a place that Jesus will be. Come on into the house of worship. Come on into the place of prayer. Come on into the holy refuge. You'll find Jesus, your very dear bed. And if you feel that you have a problem and life is closing in, if you ever needed a friend, just come on in. If you've ever needed a friend, just come on in.
Praise the Lord. I hope you know you're here for a reason this morning. If you need a place where you've got friends, this is it. Why don't you take a few minutes and greet somebody and tell them you're glad to see them this morning.
Come on in.
This is a
never needed a friend, just come on in. If you've ever needed a friend, just come on in.
Praise the Lord. Won't you give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning, church? Praise the Lord. You can be seated this morning if you'd like. We don't have a whole lot in the way of announcements this morning, but we're so glad that you came and chose to worship with us here at Sykes and First this morning. Whether you're a regular attender or just a visitor this morning, welcome. Welcome to Sykes and First, and we hope that you feel welcome this morning. Don't forget, the pew registry is on one end or the other of the pew, if you don't mind to grab that. Let us know that you've been here this morning. Sign your name, whether you're a visitor or a regular attender. We'd like to have a record of you being here this morning, if that's okay. And then make sure you do pass it down. Let everybody else get a chance to sign that as well. Don't forget, tomorrow in the fireside room, they're going to be having their WM meeting. It starts at 6 o'clock. That wasn't on my cheat sheet here. But don't forget about it. And Sister Strand will be speaking, so you don't want to miss that. That's going to be a good time together with the ladies of the church and to hear Sister Strand speak. Don't forget to bring a finger food so that you guys will have some snacks to snack on. And just come expecting tomorrow evening. Like I said, I don't have a whole lot else in the way of announcements, so I think we all just get right back into worship. Amen. We're going to have another sit-down, stand-up moment. So why don't we just stand right back up? We're going to get right into worship.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And though these are days of great trial, a famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. If you're born, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel. The dry bones become in his flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding your temple of praise. And those are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your own. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, shining on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
And there's no God like Jehovah.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, it's your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. And out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
And there's no God.
There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
Praise the Lord. Looking forward to that day. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord Jesus.
Praise is rising. Jesus, we. Oh, be stirring hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Sing that first verse again.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. And hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. Return to you. And in your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. We're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. Welcome you here, Lord Jesus. When we see you, we find strength to face the day.
Thank you, Lord.
In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
Sing that again.
When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away in Hosanna. Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Glory to your name. Church, just lift your hands and worship him. That's our prayer, Lord. Just come have your way with us, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. We just give your Holy Spirit permission to take control of this service and take control of our lives, Lord God. Every one of us are here for a reason, Lord. We're here for what you have for us. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to your name.
I believe you are.
You know, he tells us if we have need of him, just to ask of him. Just believe that in your heart, that he's more. And I love that it says at the end of that, it's nothing is impossible for you because you hold my world in your hands. That tells me he knows everything that we need. He just is waiting on us to believe that he can do it. Just praise his name this morning, church. Lift your hands and thank him. Thank him for what you need because he has it. Glory to your name, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. I believe this morning, Lord, that you are our healer, Lord God. Hallelujah. Praise your name, Lord Jesus.
Almighty reigns. Worthy is the Lamb, for you are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb.
He's worthy to receive honor, praise, glory. He's also, we've been singing this morning, it's a God that heals. If you're here this morning and you have a prayer need, need somebody to pray for you, anointing with oil and pray that prayer of faith, and you have a physical need, spiritual need, if you didn't come right now, we have some prayer partners that'll come and we'll pray for you, anointing you with oil. Anybody have that need this morning? Just make your way to the front and we'll pray with you and for you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We'll just wait a moment or two. Yes. Just make your way down if you want that prayer. That prayer team right here is ready to go. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. As we begin to pray this morning, let me read some scripture for you as well, and then we'll follow that with a special need in the name of Jesus. God is here. Join with us that are praying for one another. God is here this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we pray a prayer of faith. We do everything we know how to do, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Call for the elders of the church, anoint them with oil, and the prayer of faith that is made shall bring healing in Jesus' name. 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 Lord, we ask for healing now this moment. In Jesus' name. There is no other name given among men whereby we might be saved. There is no other name that gives us that authority to declare healing in your name. In your name. In your name. And in Jesus' name. We pray for our sister this morning. God be God in her life. Whatever the need, in Jesus' name, we believe that you're the God that's here to heal, to encourage and to strengthen, bring healing. Bring healing in Jesus' name as we release our faith and as we are as obedient as we know how to be in Jesus' name. Touch brother in Jesus' name. Give Herbie a great touch of God in your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And as we pray and continue to pray, we pray one for another. We pray one for another in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Paul gave us instructions as some specifics we are also to pray for. I urge you then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession this morning right here, and thanksgiving be made for everyone. For kings, and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the faith. There is one God, one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. So when we pray through the mediator, we are to pray for one another, prayer requests, intercessions, thanksgiving. But also to pray for those in authority. And when you look across the spectrum of what's happening in our nation, again this week, tragedy. 4 servicemen killed. Not doing anybody any harm. But what's happening in our world, we need to pray for those that are rulers and authority and kings. So join, let's pray again in Jesus' name. Now we have prayed specifically for these needs this morning. We have brought a prayer request. We did in your name. We've anointed with oil. And the prayer of faith that is prayed shall save the sick. And the Lord shall make them whole. The Lord shall bring the healing. And Lord, we pray for those in authority that rule over us. Our administrators, the people that are in authority from our president on down. We pray for them this morning to give them wisdom, to lead our nation and our country in such a way that we will have lives of peaceful existence. As we pray for them, we pray, Lord, come on the scene and be God. We know that you're in charge. And we have reaffirmed that this morning with our relationship with you. And Lord, we give you praise and we give you thanksgiving for all men, all in authority. All that are here this morning, we give you thanks. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we sing it again, Travis? The chorus? And it's praise and it's worship. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let me worship the praise. Yes, he does. He reigns. And just give him praise. Thank you. We give you our thanksgiving this morning. We thank you that we can give you praise. We thank you for our nation. We thank you for our country. And Lord, we pray that our prayers are heard to make a difference in the world in which we live. Thank you that you care about us. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Everybody said it. Amen. 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 Life is good. God is good. And he's still on the throne. Amen.
God is good. Amen. Well, that ought to get a better amen than that. God is good. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You can be seated this morning if you'd like. We're going to take up our morning tithes and offerings as we continue to worship the Lord with our giving. Brother Ron, would you mind standing and ask the Lord to bless the offering this morning? Amen. God bless you as you give back to the Lord.
Feel. the urge within you to submit to earthly fears. Don't let the faith you're standing in seem to disappear. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
He can work with those who praise Him. Praise the Lord. Our God can have its praise. Praise the Lord. For the chains that seem to bind you serve only to remind you they'll fall powerless behind you when you praise Him. Now Satan is a liar, and he tries to make you think you're a pauper when he knows himself you're a child of the King. So lift up the mighty shield of faith, for the battle must be won. We know that Jesus Christ has risen, and the work's already done. Praise the Lord. He can work with those who praise Him. Praise the Lord. Our God inhabits praise. Praise the Lord. For the chains that seem to bind you serve only to remind you they'll fall powerless behind you when you praise Him.
I want to sing that second verse again. We've gone through some struggles as a church. But you know, when the life gives you lemons, what can we do? We can make lemonade out of it, can't we? Praising the Lord, we can do that. Amen. He'll take that circumstance that you're in right now and He'll change it if you'll just praise Him. Now Satan is a liar, and he tries to make you think. Now Satan is a liar. Get that now. And he tries to make you think you're a pauper when you know yourself you're a child of the King.
Amen.
So lift up your mighty shield of faith, for the battle must be no won. We know that Jesus Christ has risen, and the work's already done. Praise the Lord. He can work with those who praise Him. Praise the Lord. Our God inhabits praise. Praise the Lord. For the chains that seem to bind you serve only to remind you they'll fall powerless behind you when you praise Him. When you praise Him. When you praise.
Thank you, Terry. It's a powerful song with a powerful message. Take it with you this week. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. This morning, I'd like to talk to you about a subject about how to change your past. How to change your past. A pastor in a small church said, "Today I'm preaching on the 29th chapter of Matthew." How many in this congregation have read the 29th chapter of Matthew? You're the people I want to talk to. There's only 28 chapters in the book of Matthew. There we go. Well, anyway, the Jewish rabbi and a Catholic priest were meeting at the town's annual 4th of July picnic. Old friends. They began their usual banter back and forth, and the priest said to the rabbi, "The baked ham is really delicious. You really ought to try it. I know it's against your teachings, but I can't understand why such a wonderful food should be forgiven or forbidden. You don't know what you're missing. You just haven't lived until you've tried Mrs. Hall's prized Virginia baked ham. Tell me, Rabbi, when are you going to break down and try it? The rabbi looked at the priest with a big grin and said, at your wedding. Am I going too fast? You know, there are two things really bother us in humanity and living. An unchangeable past that we seem to have, we'd like to recreate segments of our past, but we're stuck with our past histories. Then we worry about our unpredictable future. What is ahead of us for our future? How can we, and we long to control our destiny, but you can't seem to bring the future under control. Two basic longings are at the root of most of our problems. We cannot alter a painful past. We can't control a threatening future. These two longings, but God is the only one that offers an answer that I know of. Let's deal with the changing of the past today, and the next message on Sunday morning we'll deal with how to deal with that future concerns. But God is a forgiving God who recreates our past by forgiving them, and by His grace we can participate in the power to change the past and really control the future. So let's read a couple of texts this morning. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, at verse 12. We have said this many, many times when we repeated the Lord's Prayer. Verse 12, Matthew 6, forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive men or women when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive you your sins. Pretty pointed. Let's go to Colossians chapter 3. There we go. Sometimes I forget where I'm going until I'm there. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy, dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. Now, we have had a lesson in forgiveness brought to us, made headlines. When can you remember forgiveness making headlines of the news, newspaper, and also on telecasts? When the church in South Carolina, at a prayer meeting, lost nine of their members of their church, it wasn't but a day or two later when we had more than one person standing forth and speaking, we forgive the shooter. Now, I don't know if I could do that. How about you? An African Methodist Episcopal Church, AME, showed us how to forgive. In fact, the entire nation gave us a lesson. We too can forgive. In fact, to live a good life, we must forgive. Now, by sharing in this divine power, we become more powerfully human than we ever, and more godlike than we've ever been. It sets us free, forgiveness. Now, Hannah Arendt, who was a Jewish philosopher, wrote a book called The Human Condition, and she turns to this power of the human spirit and concludes that the only way we can fashion a future is to take care of a past, and of the biblical Lord can we overcome the darkest forebodings of our life with this thing called, and she said, only one remedy for the inevitability of our past history, forgiveness. Only one remedy for the past history, forgiveness. Now, in the natural course of life, we are stuck with our past and its effects on us. Now, we can learn from history, but you cannot escape it. You can forget your history, but you can't undo it. You can't undo it. We may be doomed to repeat it, but we can't change it. Our past is a part of us, whether we like it or not. But one thing only can release us from the grip of the past. It's called forgiveness. something we really don't want to deal with very often. It's tough. Now, Jesus urges us to forgive for a greater reason. He said, and when you stand praying, forgive. If you have anything against anybody else, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive you your trespasses. It's a two-way street. So when we look at our subject, what do we do when we forgive? Why forgive? How do we forgive? Number one, what do we do when we forgive? Now, forgiveness has at least three stages. Every act of forgiveness: suffering, spiritual surgery, and starting over. The first stage is suffering, creates the conditions that require forgiveness. Secondly, the stage of spiritual surgery, we do the essential business of forgiving. We cut away the past. Spiritual surgery. The third stage is starting over, like a new relationship, beginning on a new plane again, a new foundation, starting all over again. Let's look at suffering. No one can really forgive unless he has been really hurt. We turn this miracle into cheap indulgence when we say, I forgive you, I forgive you, I forgive you, for people that have never hurt us. You know, unless you speak of something of hurt, don't speak of forgiveness. Now, not every hurt needs to be forgiven. There are hurts to be shrugged off. There are hurts to be swallowed. There are hurts to chalk up to the fact that we are all human beings. We should not try to forgive some things. For consider, for annoyances. Do you get annoyed by some things? Annoyances. People annoy us by telling the same old stale stories. They annoy us by cutting ahead of us at the checkout stand. They annoy us by cutting in front of us when we're driving our car. It's like the little boy who is driving with his mother. Dad's not here. And she's looking at him in his car seat, and his head is going back and forth, and he's looking up, looking. Finally, she says, son, what are you doing? He said, I'm just looking for all the blooming idiots that Dad finds every time he drives a car. Some of those things need to be. Defeats. Some people succeed when we fail. They get the promotions, and we're always one step behind them. Slights. Some people want to impress, don't notice us when we'd like to have them noticed. The boss didn't invite us to the daughter's wedding, for instance. Now, these are hurts, but they're not the kind of things that really need forgiveness. These are the things which need tolerance and indulgence and a little bit of humility and just, it's life. But the kind of needs that need forgiveness are deep and hurt and moral. The sort of hurts that builds walls, that cuts deep, that slices the fiber that holds us together. For example, the acts of disloyalty and the acts of betrayal. There may be other things, but these two seem to fit into the category we're talking about most. So what is a disloyal act? A person is disloyal if he or she treats you like you are a stranger when in fact you belong as a friend or a relative or a partner or a family member. Now, each of us are bound to people by the invisible fibers we call loyalty. It's the bonding that tells us who we really are. That's why disloyalty is so serious. Words like abandoned or forsaken or let down come to mind. For example, a husband has an affair with his wife's best friend. A partner you're in business with promised to come through with a loan that's most needed in your business and reneged at the last moment because he found another place to get more interest on his money. A friend promises to recommend you for a promotion at business until you find out that the boss doesn't like you. And so your friend backs off and doesn't make the recommendation. Or your father fails to show up when you're given a coveted prize. You wanted him at your recital. You wanted him at that special ball game. When you are Your neighbor spurns you when you're a Jew, when you need a place to hide from the Gestapo. turn the screws a little bit tighter, and disloyalty becomes betrayal. Disloyalty makes strangers of people who belong to each other, but betrayal turns them into enemies. We betray when we cut into pieces. For instance, Peter was disloyal when he denied Jesus Christ. Judas betrayed Jesus when he turned him over to the enemies. He took disloyalty one step farther. He betrayed Jesus. You can betray me when you take a secret that I trusted with and you reveal it to someone who's going to use it against me to hurt me some more in the future. You betray me when you promise to be my friend but whisper my secret scheme, my secret skin, my secret sin to a gossiper who is going to tell it to the world. You betray me when you are my brother, my sister, my wife, my husband, my mother, my cousin, when you put me down in front of significant people, when I have no defense. A son betrays his father. When he tells the commissar that the father has prayed for the defeat of communism. These all have the same feature. Someone who is committed to be on your side turns against you and you become enemies. That's betrayal. Hurt. Deep. Long time. The hurt is still there. So spiritual surgery needs to take place. This stage involves the hurt person's inner response to the person who did you wrong. When you forgive, you are slicing away from that person that act that so hurt you, so degraded you, so betrayed you. You disengage that person from the harmful act. You recreate that situation in your memory. At the moment you identify him or her as a dirty rascal who did you wrong, the next moment you change that identity. He or she is remade in your memory. Now you think of that person not as the person who hurt you, but as a person who now needs a relationship with you. You recreate your past by recreating that person in that moment in your memory. God does this too, but he does it so much better than we do. He releases us from the sin, like your mother washed the dirt out of your ears. It's gone. Or the person who takes the burden off your back and lays it on a goat and sends the goat into the wilderness to be the scapegoat for your sins. Now, sometimes this is only as far as we can go. Spiritual surgery. Sometimes we need to forgive people who are dead and gone. How do you handle that? Again, that memory can be recreated. Sometimes we have to forgive people who don't want our forgiveness. Sometimes our forgiving has to end with what happens in the spiritual surgery of our memories, and that's as far as we can go. But let's talk about starting over. Starting over, sometimes we are like the little girl who, because of her bad behavior, was banished to a mother's closet for her behavior. All of a sudden, the mother realizes it's getting too quiet. I better go check what's happening. And the mother checks and says, "What are you doing, honey?" came the reply. "I'm waiting for more pit so I can pit all over your new shoes." The miracle of forgiveness is completed when two alienated people start all over again. A man holds out his hand to a daughter, says, "And I want to be your father again." A woman holds out her arms and says, "I want to be your wife again." Or a friend says to you, "I want to be your friend again. I forgive you. Let's be reconciled. Let's be together. We belong together." Reconciliation is the personal reunion of people who have been alienated but who belong together. It's the beginning of a new journey. We must begin where we are. We must begin where we are with this thing called forgiveness. The future may be uncertain. We don't understand what happened. Loose ends are untied. But we want to live with no more hurts from the past to darken our future. Now, forgiveness is not forgetting. All some of us need is a bad memory or a compulsion to suppress it, and we do the miracle when we remember and then forgive. Forgiveness is not forgetting. Forgiving is not excusing. We have a tendency to excuse people when we understand that what they did, they are not to blame. You may have a Y chromosome where you should have an X chromosome. When we find that out, it's easy to forgive people that can't help themselves in the genetic code. Or wouldn't you know that I become the way I am because I had a wacky mother who knocked me into neuroses? Forgiveness happens when we refuse to excuse people. Forgiving is not smoothing things over either. Mothers shush us and smother us. And they keep the lid on our conflicts. Mothers, world's greatest shushers. And managers get fat salaries, for in the business world, smoothing things over so people will work together for a purpose, he does that through manipulating them. Yeah, whatever. So mothers and managers are the great over-smoothers of the world. Wow. Forgiving happens only when we first admit our hurt and scream our hate. Shout it into the future. Now, forgiveness is outrageously painful. When you reach into the unchangeable past and cut away the wrong from the person who wronged you so bad, and you let them go free, you erase the hurt in the archives of your heart. When you pull it off, you do the one thing that can set you free, the only thing that can bring memory and a remedy to an unforgiving, difficult past experience is forgiveness. Now, the grace to forgive comes from God. We can't do it. We can't do it. The grace to forgive comes from God. The decision to forgive is ours. The grace to forgive comes from God. The decision to do it is your decision. Your decision. So that brings us to the second point we're talking about. Why forgive? Why go through all of this? Why do we forgive? Now, to the guilty, forgiveness is amazing grace. To the offended, forgiveness sounds like outrageous justice. We want revenge. We want to get even. In fact, we want more than even. We want to already have a payback. Forgiving is for suckers. Forgiving is for people who don't know how to do it. Simon Wiesenthal was a prisoner in the Mauthausen prison camp during the Holocaust in Poland. His job was he was assigned to clean out the rubbish from a barn that the Germans had turned into a hospital for their wounded. And toward evening one day, a nurse took Wiesenthal by the hand and led him to a young Nazi SS trooper who lay in a bed, face bandaged with pus-soaked rags, eyes tucked behind the gauze. He was about 21, 22 years old, and he grabbed Wiesenthal's hand and held it. Why? He had to talk to a Jew. He felt he could not die before he confessed the sins he had committed against the helpless Jews before he died. He told a horrible story of gunning down helpless Jews, women and children, as they fled from an apartment house that he and his SS troopers had set on fire. It was a horrible story. He told of his whole story that had been started out with an innocent youth. His participation in evil. And at the end, Wiesenthal jerked his hand away and walked out without saying a word. No forgiveness was given. Wiesenthal would not and could not forgive in that moment. But he was not sure that he did the right thing, and he wrote his story in a book called The Sunflower, told the story that was in there. And he ends it with the question, what would you have done? What would you have done? Some things are so big and so horrible, how can we forgive them? If you'd had a relative gunned down at a prayer service, Can you walk out to the press and say, I forgive the shooter? I don't know that I could. Many of us feel the same way. What would you have done? Sometimes our hate is the only thing we can hold on to. Sometimes it's our only ace. Contempt is our only weapon to have. And our plan is to get even at any cost. Some of that just keeps us moving. That's the fire that burns inside. Why should we forgive and let others go free when they need to pay the price like I've been paying the price? Wrongs. We still think it should be an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Hit for hit. Slam for hand. Slam. Hurt for hurt. But forgiving releases us from an unfair past. If we choose, you can stick with the past. If you do not forgive, revenge becomes our only recourse, but revenge glues us to the past. You're never going to be free. It dooms us to repeat over and over and over the pain and the agony that goes with it. Revenge never works because people keep scores differently. How many Holocausts do we have to have? How many times? How many put-downs are going to equal the slap in the face that you got at an important time? Forgiving takes us off the elevator of revenge. We can start all over again. We start over if the wrongdoer has done nothing and let him go free. Forgiving brings a release to the forgiver. It's the hurting person who most feels the burden of unfairness. It's unfair. But he or she only condemns himself to more unfairness if we refuse to forgive. So is it fair to be walloped again and again and again by the unfairness of the past, of the hurt? Why keep banging yourself? It's like having a CD planted in your soul that cannot be turned off. It plays itself again and again and again. The painful scene comes over and over and over again. Forgiving is going to turn off the DVD of a painful memory. Forgiving sets you free. Forgiving is the only way back to living a healthy spiritual life. So, thirdly, how do we forgive? How? I need to say something about how to forgive because I'm not the world's best forgiver. I've struggled with this. I really don't know how. But we can't do it without God's help. This much I know. You can't do it without God's help. We can't, but we have to do it anyway. Sometimes, somehow, we're like fumbling amateurs. You don't know what to say. You don't know how to do it. But there are some things about people that forgive that I've noticed. Some people forgive slowly. I don't know many instant forgivers. I don't know many people that can step out in front of a camera and say, I forgive what happened 24 hours ago. I don't know that I can do that. We shouldn't count on power to forgive bad hurts very quickly. C.S. Lewis, author, Christian philosopher, had a monster for a teacher when he was a boy. A monster for a teacher. He hated this academic sadist all his life. But a few months before he ended his life, before he died, he wrote to an American friend this little note. Dear Mary, did you know that only a few weeks ago I suddenly realized that I had at last forgiven that cruel schoolmaster who so darkened my childhood days. I have been trying to do it for years. God takes his time with a lot of things. Perhaps the miracle needs some time in your life in order to be completed. Don't throw in the sponge. If you can't do it instantly, don't throw in the sponge. It can happen as we go on. And another thing I've noticed is they forgive communally, in community. Can anyone forgive alone? I don't know. I don't think they can. I need people who hurt like I hurt. I need people who hate like I hate. I need persons who are struggling as hard as I struggle before I can come to the point of forgiving. That's why a community of a church is so wonderful. It's fine if you can do it all by yourself. But if you look hooked into that DVD, that video, that whatever this goes through your past pain, seeking a fellowship of slow forgivers might be the answer. We need help. to forgive. Jesus said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. We need to pray that same prayer. And we need to do it over and over again. And I've noticed one more thing. People that forgive, forgive as they are forgiven. People that forgive, forgive as they are forgiven. When it comes to it, anyone who forgives can hardly tell the difference between feeling forgiving and doing the forgiving. Let me say that again. People who forgive can hardly tell the difference about the feeling of being forgiven or the doing of the forgiving. We are such a mixture of sinners and saints. And we cannot forgive people who offend us without feeling that we are being set free ourselves. It just happens simultaneously. There's something about that release that nothing else in the world can begin to compare with that. Corrie Ten Boom, who is now gone to glory, you maybe remember her story out of the Second World War. She was stuck for years. They had, in their home, had helped provide sanctuary for hundreds and hundreds of Jewish people until finally they were caught and their family was placed into the prison camp. Her sister died while she was there. Both of her parents died. Corrie was the only survivor in that concentration camp. She was humiliated. She was degraded, especially in the delousing shower, where the women were ogled and jeered at and made fun of by the guards that were there. She made it through that hell, eventually. And eventually she felt, by the grace of God, she had forgiven all the hurt that had happened to her during those years that had been so painful. So she wrote the book. She traveled the world. She traveled Europe talking about forgiveness for individuals. This is what she preached. She preached it in Europe. She came to America. She preached it in America, in the United States. We listened to her one day in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, as she talked about forgiveness. One Sunday, while she was speaking about forgiveness in Munich, Germany, at the close, after her message, she was greeting people. She saw a man come toward her with his hand outstretched. He says, Ja, Fräulein, it is wonderful that Jesus forgives us all our sins, just like you said. Then she remembered his face. It was one of the guards, the lecherous, leering, obscene guards that had been mocking in that shower stall for her. Her hand flows at her side. She could not forgive. She thought she had forgiven everything. But when she stood face to face with one of her enemies that had so abused her, she couldn't forgive. Ashamed, she said, and horrified, she prayed, God, forgive me. I cannot forgive. Help me, Lord. But as she prayed, she felt that moment of forgiveness accepted in spite of her shabby performance as a world-famous forgiver. Her hand was suddenly unfrozen. The ice of hate melted in a moment. Her hand went out. She forgave as she felt forgiven in that moment. And I suspect she couldn't tell the difference between being forgiven or forgiving. It all kind of goes together. Free at last. Free at last is the song that's been sung many times. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last. Freed by the only remedy that take care of the inevitability of a painful, hurtful past. To forgive is to put down your 50-pound pack after a 10-mile climb up a mountain. To forgive is to fall into a chair after running a 26-mile marathon. To forgive is to set a prisoner free and discover in reality that the prisoner was you. To forgive is to reach back into your hurting past and recreate it in your memory so that you can begin again. To forgive is to dance to the beat of God's forgiving heart. To forgive is to ride the crest of love's strongest wave. To forgive is to approach the very attributes of God the Father himself. Our only escape from history's cruel unfairness, our only passage to the future's creative possibilities, is the miracle of forgiving. The miracle of forgiving. Stand with me, please. Now, Heavenly Father, this is a powerful moment in a church service. There are people here worshiping with us who need to forgive their God. There are people here this morning that need to be forgiven by God. There are other people here, Lord, that need to forgive themselves, which may be the toughest forgiveness of all. Some among us need to forgive someone or many someones out of our past. But God, we all need help. We all need help. We have memories of the hurt of the past. People are gone, but we still need to forgive. And Lord, you put it so pointed to us. If we cannot forgive a brother or a sister whom we have seen, how are we going to be able to be forgiven by you? God, help us this morning. God, help us this morning. God, help us this morning. I pray that you would, the Holy Spirit, just quietly walk between the aisles. And Lord, if hurts are coming back and they still have pain, that means they still need to be forgiven. If they still hurt, they need to be forgiven. If they still cause pain and a painful memory, that's a hurt that needs to be forgiven. I don't know how far back we have to go, Lord. But help us, help us, help us to be forgivers, because so much depends on it. Our future depends on it. Our lifestyle depends on it. Our peace of mind depends on this. Lord, to be beaten and flogged by a memory of the past, we don't want that anymore. Forgive us, because we have not been good forgivers. I don't know how to end a service like this. But I think we need to reaffirm some things in our relationship. Maybe you feel like you just need to come and fall on your face around an altar and just cry again, Lord. Here I am again. I need to take care of this business for you and with you. God help us. God help us. Would you like to come down and gather as a church family around here? And communally, we'll pray and cry and do an act of forgiving. Come on down, join us. Let's stand at the front. And we'll make some affirmations together. We'll just ask God to be among us as only He can be among us. Hallelujah. I've never, ever met a congregation that wasn't hurting over some issue or something of the past. And oh, how we need it. How we need to be forgiven and to forgive. In Jesus' name. Would you repeat with me together before we really go to prayer? The grace to forgive comes from God. The grace to forgive comes from God. The decision to forgive is mine. The decision to forgive is mine. Let's pray. Let's ask God to help us this morning. Holy Spirit, again, I don't know why you've directed our thoughts, my thoughts, in this pathway, but you do things well. It was by ordaining that we are all here this morning to hear this. And there is a reason why we're here to hear this. Lord, we need to be healed. We need to become whole. We need to become well. And some of the things that we are being asked to forgive are beyond pain. They're hurt. And Lord, from this moment, in the name of Jesus, help us to forgive. Help us to forgive. Help us to forgive. We forgive those of the past. Maybe they don't even know that they've hurt us. Maybe they're dead and maybe they're gone. But in these next few moments, Lord, do the miracle. Help us do the miracle in our spirit. In the name of Jesus, now speak your prayer. Speak your forgiveness to the Lord. Speak it out of your heart as the Holy Spirit deals with us. Dear Lord, do your work. Do your work. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, move upon our hearts, Lord. Jesus, help us. Help me. In your name. In your name. In your name. In your name. Oh, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Do your work this morning within us, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, and only you know when you forgive. I can't do it for you, but you'll know. There'll be something that'll happen in your spirit when you know. A week from Sunday, I'll tell you how to be reconciled and how to move into the future. We'll take this to a next step. But some of you this morning have done business with God, right? The Holy Spirit has been here. You've been confronted with something maybe you didn't plan to be confronted with this morning. But God does things well. You may need to go home and send an email. Snail mail. Phone call. And offer forgiveness. We forgive in our heart, but then we'll do it with an action as well. As well. The Holy Spirit will help you. You'll do it. And you'll be set free. Be set free. Free at last. And you will sing it. Thank God, I'm free at last. So let's say this again. The grace to forgive comes from God. The decision to forgive is mine. No cheap forgiveness. It's all pain. But when done with an honest heart, to walk together and rebuild a relationship, what joy, what fun, what excitement. So, let's say it one more time, and then we're going to bless ourselves before we leave. The grace to forgive comes from God. The decision to forgive is mine. And it is the miracle called forgiveness. It is the miracle called forgiveness. And when you pull it off, wow, there's absolutely nothing that can compare with that moment. Now, I am blessed with a generous spirit and a giving heart. I am blessed with the power to forgive. I am blessed with the power to set a prisoner free. And I am blessed that when I forgive, I am the prisoner I set free. Hallelujah. Let's give Him praise, shall we? Let's just thank God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, if you need to go to somebody right here this morning on the way out of church and just say, I forgive you, you can do it. You're in God's house. Maybe we need to. Maybe we need something to forgive. And think of what could start whole new beginnings, whole new future, whole new excitement. So God, I pray that we go in peace, we go in love, we go with a forgiving heart to bring honor and glory to you, because you are the forgiving God. And when we pull it off, we are so close to your nature, the God nature within us. Thank you for that privilege. Go in peace. God bless you. Amen. Amen.